A bit of my background, how I got to be Mr. Olympia. Started bodybuilding and competing in 1985. So my first competition, novice competition in 1985. I've been training for less than 2 years and I won the competition, but it was more than that. It was like everybody was kind of freaking out, all the judges, all the officials, because nobody knew who I was. Like everybody on the British bodybuilding scene, they pretty much knew each other and they've been around for years. So I was the new kid on the block. And the judges and the officials from the federation basically told me, like, you're like the best bodybuilder we've got in the country. Like, where the fuck did you come from? Like, you know, like, I said, well, I'm coming from Birmingham and this is my first competition. So I thought I'd come in the novices. And they're like, they're almost like laughing at me, like, You're the best heavyweight bodybuilder we've got in the country. Like, I actually, you know, I knew I was pretty good, but I didn't know, I wasn't that confident thinking I was that good. So that was my start. And I went directly from being a novice, as the federation was impressed. They invite me to compete in the World Games as a heavyweight, which is a world championship. So I went from one weekend, I think it was the next weekend or 2 weekends later, competing in the world championship with the best amateurs in the world. And the guy that won that contest was Barry DeMay. So he went on to be a top six placer in the Olympia. So I got seventh place there in that competition, which was really good, I suppose, as it was, I was coming from a novice competition to a world championship, but I still didn't like losing. So I said in the future, because I was kind of persuaded to go into that contest, and I said in the future I'm going to take control of everything. I'm going to compete only when I'm totally ready and I feel I'm ready. So then the next one was the British Championship, 86. I won that. Didn't win the overall because some political maneuvering, which is the first time I kind of come across that. It happens in all areas of life, I suppose. But I didn't get upset about it. I came back in 88, won the contest, heavyweight overall, turned pro. And, you know, this is the 80s, so it was a different landscape in bodybuilding. Professional bodybuilding was very much dominated by Americans. There was a couple of guys from UK that did okay. I mean, Bertel Fox was the most well-known. He competed in the Olympia and got top four, I think. But I think the attitude was like, yeah, you can't beat the Americans, like, and this and that, and you don't know anybody, and you haven't been in the magazines. So when you go to compete in America, it's going to be really tough. And I said, you know what, I'm not listening to any of that. I'm just going to make myself as good as I can be. And if you're really good, then I think these things don't really matter too much. Like, you don't know the judges, you're not in the magazines, you don't have publicity. And I went New York, I got second in my first pro show, which I kind of made a commitment to myself as I was doing this thing, like 100%. I mean, nothing else existed. I just wanted to be a pro bodybuilder. And if I couldn't make the top five in my first pro show, then to be quite brutally honest with myself, I'm not good enough. I'm not good enough to be that guy, to be one of the best. And with all the sacrifices you're making, and let's be honest, potential health risk that you're taking while using steroids and what have you, I had to justify that. So I said, if I can't make it in the top five in my first pro show, then all this that I'm doing is not really worth it. Yeah? I can do other things. Not like I'm going to stop training and stop bodybuilding. I opened a gym. 1980s, there was very few gyms around, so little gyms making quite a good return. I could open another one and another one maybe, and so there was an alternative, but I didn't want to be one of these guys because I saw lots of them neglect their family, neglect their income, the job, neglect everything for this dream. That ain't happening. It ain't happening, yeah? Because bodybuilding is like any other sport, basketball, whatever. You've got to be born with a certain amount of potential to be a professional bodybuilder. Not everybody can do it, yeah? And I saw guys neglecting everything for a dream that's never going to happen. So I didn't want to fall into that category. And, you know, the people around you, I had a son, had a girlfriend, you lose time, you lose focus. All this has got to be justified. So and that was the turning point for me. So if I hadn't got in the top five of that pro show, then Dorian Yates, Mr. Olympia, and the guy sitting here wouldn't exist. I'd probably be a gym owner and maybe you never heard of me. But fortunately, I got second and it was fairly close. And Joe Weider, who basically, you know, there was no internet. Joe Weider's magazines was everything in bodybuilding. And if you got in his magazine, you made it. So I went to New York, got second, and Joe Weider actually flew me out to California to do his photo shoots and everything for the magazine, and not the guy that won, because he saw something in me that was like different and maybe marketable, niche, or something like that. Anyway, so they flew me out there, got my first cover on Flex magazine, and you know, I was on my way. And next year I went back, won the pro show, got second in Mr. Olympia on my first try. And then the next time, the next to Mr. Olympia was the win. And then, you know, there's a whole story about that six Mr. Olympias, some ups, some downs, and everything. But there it's in the record books, six times Mr. Olympia, only Mr. Olympia from UK. And, you know, bodybuilding is different now. It's much more international. You've got a lot of people from around the world competing as a pro. Then it was, as I say, mostly American based. So the fact that I came from England and won the Mr. Olympia kind of changed it a bit. Now, you know, once one person does it, the other people start thinking, well, if he can do it, I can do it. And that's the way things change, but somebody has to go first. So just a little bit of brief information for you guys, in case some of you don't know, a little bit of my background. Well, I'm sure you got a lot you want to talk about, a lot of questions you want to ask, and as Mike said, like, I don't give a shit what you ask me. There is no questions you shouldn't ask, because I'm here to share with you, I'm here to teach, you're here to learn, and if I'm saying you can't ask me this and you can't ask me that, then I'm not a very good teacher, yeah? So whatever you want to ask me is fine.
Yeah, I want to ask, obviously, a lot of us here have competed and stuff, and we've got in condition and we know what it feels like, but we've never been to obviously Dorian Yates kind of level. Can you describe what that felt like?
You mean like the conditioning, getting ready for a competition?
When you got to that grainy kind of, what was it actually feeling like?
Popped up last year, you won almost every single show as an amateur, and you won Term Pro. Everyone in the industry wants Dan for Term Pro. It's not something he wants to do because
A lot of people have been pushing me to do it. I've been competing a while now and say I have the potential for it, but I haven't seen any evidence from many, you know, potential pros. Well, people have gone pro that they're happy.
Yeah.
Just happiness. You know, when I got in this game, I looked at people like yourself. I looked at, you know, just flex. Me training, I was just happy.
Yeah.
And I don't want to forget that. And when I look at a lot of pros, I'm not inspired by their happiness.
Yeah, they lost the love, they lost the passion, because it's very difficult to manage that, because you're doing something you love, but the something you love is now becoming a business as well, and that changed the whole thing, and it's a very hard balance. I was quite good at it because I'm not really money motivated. It's nice, I like to get it, you know, I like to live comfortably, but it was not my motivation, and I could have earned possibly double of what I earned if I wanted to just see it as cold business, but it never was. I never lost that hunger, that excitement when I'm driving to the gym about what can I do today? Can I beat? I've kept that, like, you know, that feeling that you have early on when you're a beginner, and you know, it's a passion, yeah? So that's why I also stayed living in Birmingham. When, yeah, nobody in Birmingham knew who I was or what I was doing. They didn't give a shit. I mean, even the people that I live next door to, you know, eventually I'm earning good money. I got a big house, six bedrooms, big gardens. I live next to stockbrokers and what. And I'm just the big guy that lifts weights and has got a gym or something. That's all they know, yeah? So I was living where I was from. The people that knew me, my real friends, family. If I'd have gone to Los Angeles, which there was quite a bit of pressure to do that, then I knew I was going to lose control. I'm going to be pulled here and pulled there and have opportunity here and money here and this there. And I wouldn't be able to keep that kind of hunger that you have as an amateur. So that's usually what happens. You know, you have the opportunity to make money, which is like, wow, I'm professional now. But that's going to like pull time that you got now to enjoy your training and everything like that. And it's like, you got to balance it, which is not an easy thing to do. So yeah, it's a decision that you have to make and you have to be comfortable with.
Saying that to Jan on the way was nice. Says like, obviously you were just in a dungeon.
Yeah.
Just all the celebrity, as I say, you know, like bodybuilders, everyone knew a short amount, but they were all being pulled into magazines and photo shoots on the beach.
Yeah.
And stuff like that, and you were in a dungeon in Birmingham.
Because that's what I loved. My passion was, how far can I take this? How far can I push this? How muscular can I get? And it was like a mission that was a passion of mine. It wasn't, let's see how much money can I make. It was like, how far can I take this thing that I'm doing? Because that's something real. That's something that lasts forever. Money, it comes, it goes. And when you got 10 Ferraris, but when you die, all the Ferraris are going to turn to rust eventually. It's not going to mean anything in the end, yeah? So I was very conscious about what is of value here is this mission that I'm on. And now I can sit back. I don't have, yeah, look at this, I've got a rocking chair. I can sit back in my rocking chair and say, you know what? I fucking couldn't have done anything more. I'm not looking back, oh, if I'd have just done this, could have been a bit better or, no. Nothing, yeah? And that's the real value, yeah? Because I know a lot of people that are not in that position and are looking back and saying, you know what, if I'd have just given it a bit more and I didn't get drawn into the partying and I didn't get distracted by the money, I could have been better. And I think that's the thing of real value that you have, is like achieving your potential. That's what it's all about to me. Like, how far can I push myself? So as a professional, I still behaved like an amateur. I still stayed in the same gym. I still saved the same people. I didn't want to get drawn away from that. So that's why the whole time I was training with Mr. Olympia, I never moved. I went to America just the minimum amount of time that I had to do to, you know, some commitments that I had professionally. Apart from that, I wanted to be in my gym and training and seeing how far can we take this. So it's an ongoing thing. And as far as my conditioning, that's precision, that's dedication, that's like counting everything, every calorie, like to the OCD level. Like I was telling somebody the other day, do you know when I was getting ready for a competition, I used to weigh myself on the scales like 10 times a day. That's OCD. But in a way it kind of works, because every time I'm stepping on stage, on the scale, I'm thinking, I wanna lose weight, I wanna lose fat, I wanna burn. Like, that's all I'm thinking about all the time, you know? So yeah, to answer your question, man, like, there's very few people, there's so many pros now, yeah? It's like, it doesn't mean so much as it used to mean. It used to be one person a year from a country that could turn pro, one person. And even that one person, once they go pro, what chance have they got of really being a pro? That means you earn all your living just from this, just from the bodybuilding and the competing. So it's one thing to turn pro. That's really, really difficult. Like, you're the best amateur in your country to turn pro. But that's a different pool, yeah? You've gone from a little pool to a big pool full of monsters. And to make it there is not that easy. So turn pro, yeah, that's one thing. But there's thousands of pros, but I bet there's 10 competitive bodybuilders in the world that's making a really good living. So just the fact that you're pro don't mean you're really pro. It just means you're paying to the Federation for the privilege of having a piece of cardboard that says I'm pro on it. Yeah, they're the guys, they're the smart guys, right? They got thousands of people paying $500 a year. Work it out, yeah?
Would Dorian back then do it again now in today's world?
I mean, probably, yeah, because it's where I was drawn to and it was my... something I was very good at, and something I really enjoyed. It wasn't like some guys, they're just very talented genetically, but like sorry to use it as an example if you're listening, but Flex Wheeler, yeah. He was so gifted, it came so easy that he didn't appreciate it, and he was lazy and he didn't make the most of it. So it's different for everybody, you know? But for me, I just wanted to reach my potential, and if it was now, I'd have to deal with whatever it is now, I suppose, but it would be very difficult to do it the way I did, because now how people make money is not the way they used to make money. There was, you get in the magazines, you win contests, that's money. Yeah. You do endorsements, that's money. But it's all about the magazines, and you won't get there unless you win contests. Now there's a million and one ways to make money online where you don't need to win contests. So it's a different environment, and it seems like you need to constantly be out there in order to tap into that. So to be a pro bodybuilder and say, look, I'm just going to compete a couple of times a year and disappear and that's it. It's difficult to financially to make it now, yeah. As it was then. But I love the gym, I love training, I love pushing, but I'm really grateful that I was there doing it then and not now, because it's a different environment. You know, like the gym I used to train in was like a men's club, you know. There's a couple of ladies that work out in there, but if they come into the gym, it's a very male environment, so they'd probably be hearing what the guys did last night with some girl or something, you know what I mean? So if they can put up with that, they hang around, but it's not the kind of nice, family-friendly kind of thing that it is now. And I enjoyed that, you know, it's like a subculture almost. It's a different world that regular people don't even know about.
I know you're a big fan of high-intensity training, aren't you? At what stage in your career did you start that? And would you advise someone at my age, I'm 60 coming up, for me to do it?
Well, you know, what's high intensity for one person is might not be for another one. So I got a guy that's in his mid, late 70s and is in very bad health. I mean, you know, really bad. And I helped him get into health. But I mean, high intensity for him was doing bodyweight squats down to a bench and back up again. So it's relative to the person. It's training as intensely as you can and then balancing that with recovery. Yeah. So yes, you can do it at any age, but you've got to always tailor it to the individual. There may be some exercises that you can't do because you have some joint issues or something that you wouldn't have when he was 25, 30. So you've got to tailor it to an individual and take into account everything that's going on. But the principles apply to everybody. It's like old, young man, woman, you've got to give your body some stress that it's not used to in order for it to adapt and develop. And it also depends what your goals are. As you're getting older, muscle mass is very important. You don't need to be competitive bodybuilder level, but if you're 55, 60, 65 years old, and you can build your muscle mass back to a level that you were at 20 years old, let's say, that's going to have such a massive positive effect on your health, regulating blood sugar. A lot of people, I mean, because their diet's bad, but when you're young, you can handle it. Because you've got more muscle mass, you've got more receptors for the insulin and everything like that. As you get older and you lose that muscle mass, it affects a lot of things in a negative way. So if you put it back to where it was when you were younger, massive health benefits. And I think that's what you should be looking at as you get older. Less important, like building a competitive looking bodybuilding physique. I'm not saying you can't do it. And if you want to, maybe you can, but it's more important to look at the health aspects as you're getting older. You know, we can all get away with stuff when we're young, but as you get older, you've got to be more careful. And if you want a good quality of life when you're getting older, you need muscle, you need your bones to be strong, stuff like that. And it's some shocking statistics, like if you're 65 and you fall over and you break a hip, it's something like 78% within 2 or 3 years, you're dead. It's done because you stop moving and you don't heal properly and so on. So these are more the things I'm thinking about now. Like, well, it's nice to look good in the mirror, but it's about quality of life. So bodybuilding, weight training, is different things as you're at different ages. So I do some weights twice a week. I do Pilates or yoga once, twice a week. I ride my bike, do a bit of cardio. Just do a bit of everything, you know? Strength, mobility, cardiovascular, a little bit of everything. And you don't need to do a lot to be healthy. So that's what I'm really interested in now. You know, the competitive bodybuilding thing, like, I'm the fucking man, I'm the expert on that. But I'm also an expert on aging and aging healthily. And it's amazing what you can do with some weight training, with the correct diet and everything like that. You know, I've seen people with their blood test results really bad, and in 1 month it's totally changed. Like, blood sugar's gone down, inflammation's gone down, a lot of things that you can change. So that's what you should be looking at, I think.
After all the potential Mr. Olympias that were looking to overtake you when you were the champion, did you have in mind the most? Which one kind of got you in the morning the most?
I mean, they're all good, yeah. So the guy that I thought had the most potential, as he looked so good, and I know he wasn't really giving 100% all the time, was Flex Wheeler. So I said if he had my brain, it would be dangerous. Like, you know, I don't know. If he did what I did, shit, he looks like that and he's giving only 70%. What if he did another 20-30%? But having said that, I knew that mentally that he wouldn't do that. I kind of got his number from the start. Kevin was very good, but I never really felt like he could beat me. It was more like competition with myself, really, than like trying to beat. I mean, the guy that motivated me the most, if any of them, would be Sean Ray, just because he had a big mouth. And he used to irritate me, so. He saw me like a couple of years ago, we did a seminar, and he said, I made a mistake, didn't I? I said, well, how you mean? He said, I made a mistake talking shit about you. All it did was made you just train harder. I said, oh, thanks. I didn't say anything to your bullshit. My response is, I'll turn up on a stage and you'll be like, oh shit. That was good enough.
Olympia?
Sorry?
That's the one where you thought you'd got everything absolutely bang on. What your favorite look?
93, man. 95 was also great. In some aspects, my physique was improved in 95, but I did have the injury. 93, so I was 31 years old, no injuries, fucking animal machine, like everything went well. And that physique that I presented in 1993 was a fucking quantum leap forward for bodybuilding. Like, as far as muscle mass combined with condition, nobody had ever seen anything like that. And it was like, the first Mr. Olympia I won, I felt like, yeah, okay, this guy from England's won, but all the Americans are like, yeah, one of our boys next year could take him, yeah?
Where they had the photos where you'd made the huge difference
yeah.
in Flex magazine.
Yeah, exactly, yeah. Which is a bit illusionary, those photos, actually, because the first set were taken after the Mr. Olympia in 1992. So if you get ready for a competition, don't matter, like, as perfect as you do it, to get to that extreme level of which I was, super low body fat, and that kind of condition, you've lost some muscle as well to get in that condition, yeah? So the first set of photos are after the competition, when I'm a bit down, and the second set is like 6 weeks before the next one. So the difference is huge. And there was a big difference from 1 year to the next, but a lot of it was just me learning that the first year I just way over dieted and sacrificed too much muscle. So, and I was quite analytical about this because I took photos every week. Of course, we didn't have iPhone, and I think you got to take a picture, take it to Boots, the chemist, come back in 2 days and get your pictures and look, oh, how do I look? I mean, that's how it was. I can remember the fucking anticipation going to Boots, the chemist, and waiting for them pictures, like, mate, how do I look? Like, you know? And I'd write everything down and I'd have a picture. So I look back and I was like, wow, I was in contest shape 6 weeks out. I was much bigger and fuller. And okay, by the time the contest came around, it was a little bit sharper and a little bit more ripped, but I've lost like 10 pounds of muscle. So next year I won't do that. I'll avoid that. So there's 10 pounds. And I had a great year of training, probably put on 6 or 7 pounds of muscle. As a Mr. Olympia, that's, anyway, outstanding. So it ended up being like 20 pounds because not sacrificing and building a bit more. So that's why there was such a huge difference between those two photos. But I've got photos 6 weeks out from 92 where I look spectacular as well. So although I was known as a mass monster, I didn't really like that term because I was not just trying to be as big as I could be. I was trying to be as big combined with being shredded as well. So I could have potentially been on stage a lot bigger and heavier, but I wanted to have the conditioning like a lightweight. Basically, I wanted to look like a massive walking anatomy chart, and that's what I achieved.
What was diet and cycle running up to that competition?
Steroid cycle, you mean?
Yeah, and food. What
well, let's say average off season, I'm on 6,500 calories. So that's my off season. Contest prep, I would start probably like 4,500, 4,800.
And where would that come from? What would the split be?
Well, this is the way I look at it. You know, every subject, no matter what it is, you can make it and take it very, you make it very complex, yeah? Or you can make a complex subject very sound very simple.
Yeah.
And I think the second one is the best one. So, keeping everything simple, protein is pretty much always a constant, yeah?
Yeah.
So you should be a gram and a half of protein per pound of body weight. So if you're 200 pounds, 200 to 300 grams of protein, you can play around with it and see what, you know, if you need a bit more is a bit better or whatever, but somewhere in that area. You need fat because you need fat for hormone production, you need fat for absorption of some vitamins, various things within the body, so it's essential, yeah, to get some fat. So I'll probably get like 100 grams of fat a day. So let's say I'm on 400 grams of protein, 100 grams of fat. The rest is carbohydrates.
Yeah. The
carbohydrates is just energy. There has no other purpose, yeah?
Would you keep them in all the way through, even run up to comp?
The carbohydrates would come down.
Yeah.
If I want to gain weight, they would go up. So what I'm saying is this parameter, protein, and this fat, that's the same. So what we're doing, we're playing with this up and down. And you need to be in a negative balance. So, you know, drop 100 grams of carbs, you drop 400 calories and start from there and add in some more activity. We can call it cardio, but it's not like high intense cardio. It's just general calorie burning. So I would do like fast walking or walk outside like 45 minutes or do stationary cycling.
Yeah.
Get heart rate up, like burning calories, yeah? But it's not intense in that it's gonna take away from your weight workouts and your recovery from your weight workouts because that's your priority. We're bodybuilding, yeah?
Yeah.
Not fitness building, we're bodybuilding, yeah? So the rest is calorie burning. So drop the calories a little bit, increase the expenditure a little bit until you've got a deficit of around 1,000 calories a day, then you're going to lose around 2 pounds of fat a week, more or less. You know, it's mathematics. It's not really that complicated. But I can make it sound really complicated if I wanted to charge you more money, you know. But it's not my business. I don't rely on making money from coaching or personal training people. I do it because I really enjoy it and I like to see people improve. And I have a lot of knowledge to share, but I want to keep it simple. Because if you keep it simple and you understand it simply, you can get on with it. There's just too much information out there now. And I feel sorry for the go on YouTube and watch this guy saying this and then another guy saying something else, like his head spinning, like, what is it? Everyone's an expert, yeah? Everyone's an expert, but they're not, you know? They're not really. I am an expert. Yeah.
So
I say it as is. You can debate who's the best bodybuilder.
Yeah.
Some people might say Ronnie, probably. Some people might say whatever. It's an opinion, yeah?
Yeah.
But I'll tell you, without any ego, there is no better trainer in the gym, weight training, bodybuilding, in the world than myself. It's just the truth, yeah? It's just the truth. And I make it very simple for people to understand. It's simple. It's not voodoo, yeah? You want to lose weight, you need to be in a negative calorie balance. You eat less and burn more, like to a degree. And then you just monitor it every week. I'm on 4,500 calories, let's say. I'm losing 2 pounds a week. Well, after a few weeks, it might slow down a little bit. We'll chip off another 300 calories. Just from carbs, yeah, that's the only thing. And so come around the competition time, I'm probably under 4,000 calories, 3,800, 4,000, around about there, if I look back in my records, which is probably double what I eat now, but I was starving then because I'm 300 pound of muscle. Like, it's a machine, you know. And just monitor week by week. Weight scales, mirror, body fat calipers, you know, various things that you can monitor and keep records. And yeah, I hate to see people waste time and energy. It's hard enough anyway. Why make it harder for yourself by not recording everything and not getting the feedback and knowing what works and what doesn't work? Because if it doesn't work, eliminate it. Gone. Forget about it. Don't ever think about it again. Yeah, make it simple. Stick with what works.
So, sorry, could you just state your, making a note, your protocol for protein, where it stays, all your per pound of?
One gram to 1.5 for a pound of body weight.
One gram of protein?
To 1.5, in that range. Yeah, 1 to 1.5 per pound of body weight is a good range to be in. And, you know, you can play with it a little bit and say, I've ate more protein this month. I've gone from 1 to 1.5. Is there any benefit? Is there any improvement? Or was 1 enough? Like, you know, but it'll be in that area in my experience somewhere.
So, for example, if you're 200-pound bodybuilder, you want 200 to
300? Yeah, 200 to 300 grams a day. Spread out, because you can only absorb so much at one sitting, so you don't want to like have 150 grams of protein for breakfast and 150 grams in the evening, and then all day you haven't, you know, you kind of got, it's kind of like drip feeding, I call it. It's always there, yeah? So your protein and amino acids are building blocks, repair blocks. So you're going in the gym with a sledgehammer and you're knocking this wall down, the brick wall, you're knocking it down, yeah? Now you need some bricks to rebuild it a bit better than it was before. So your bricks are amino acids. From protein.
Obviously, it's interesting because, like you said, everyone's an expert. There's people coaching and giving their opinion. But if you measure yourself in pounds, say 200 pounds, why do we look at protein in grams and why not pounds? Is that just how it was?
I can't quite understand the question.
If you say 1 to 1.25 grams.
Yeah, per pound of body weight.
Yeah, so why do you not look at pounds is the measurement for the food as well, so kilograms.
That's probably the food industry's point of
that. Pounds, kilograms, or you know, whatever. If it's a kilogram, it'd be 2.2 to 3.3 or something like that.
Industry measures in grams and kilos.
I wonder if there was some scientific method behind that. That's the way you did it, but that's fine.
No, you measure protein in grams, same as carbohydrates. The protein. Gram of protein is 4 calories. Gram of carbohydrates 4 calories. A gram of fat is 9 calories. So that's the heat, that's the energy that it gives off. But protein it's not really meant for energy, it's meant for repair, yeah? Carbohydrates is short-term energy, fat is a long-term energy. And what we're doing, reducing that energy intake through the food, preferably from carbohydrates, so that you're in a deficit now, so that your body needs to find that energy somewhere, hopefully from the fat stores. If you make too much of a severe drop, you're going to burn muscle as well, yeah? Because your body doesn't really want to lose its body fat. It's like an emergency store for when you're starving. So your body's reluctant to give up the body fat. So you've got to do it slowly, nice and slowly. If you do it too quickly, you'll lose some fat and some muscle, which is like, that's a nightmare, man. You work really hard just to build 1 pound of muscle. You don't want to lose it, yeah? It depends on the condition the person's in, but generally, I would go with probably average 12 weeks. Yeah, I mean, if I did everything again, I mean, I know now that I got in shape in about 6-7 weeks. I was pretty much in shape, and then I was trying to hold it, but you know, it's still going down, so I'd overshoot most of the time. So if you're a fast metabolizer and you're in good shape, you could probably do it in 8 weeks, but 12 weeks gives you leeway. It gives you enough time to do a good job, most people. And the first week when you drop carbs, and I didn't get to the protocol, but I will, with the steroids and everything like that. You drop carbs, you lose water, yeah? And also if you change your anabolics from something that's water retentive to something that's not, you're gonna lose water. So the first couple of weeks on the diet, probably I might lose 4 or 5 pounds a week, but It's just water, yeah? And then after a couple of weeks, that'll settle down. And then my goal was around 2 pounds a week. That was comfortable to lose 2 pounds a week, and I could not lose muscle. If I was like trying to lose 5 pounds a week and rush the prep to a contest, then you're going to lose muscle. So it doesn't make sense. So do it nice and slowly. 12 weeks is a good average, I would say.
So today's bodybuilding. So you called yourself the original mass.
I don't. Somebody else.
No, somebody else did. Yeah. Yeah, that's right. Yeah, yeah. So you called yourself. So you were the original. What do you think of the bodybuilding today? You know, like how big they are. You know, like what's your opinion on how they look today? Because I think when we used back in the day when you were doing it and Arnold and stuff like that, you see it gradually getting bigger, and then you obviously come with a different look and more.
Well, so some of the guys are bigger now, I suppose, but they don't combine it with the conditioning. They're just big. For me, all the guys that compete in the open bodybuilding now, for me, they look like, yeah, you got another 6 weeks to go, mate. Like, you ain't near. That's what it looks like to me. Because they've just gone for size.
Too big, isn't it?
Where myself and all the other people that were trying to beat me, we were going for size, but you had to be sliced as well. But there was just bodybuilding. Now there's, like, there's so many different categories, right? You've got physique, you've got classic, you've got open bodybuilding. So yeah, some of the guys are heavier on stage, but I don't think they're as good. Well, I get the question all the time, and then, you know, I just have to give you the answer. Some people are going to get pissed off, like, oh, they're always saying it was better in the 90s. Well, yeah, because it was. Yeah.
Would you never take anyone to stage now yourself personally? Would you not be?
I am. I've been asked, but I never found somebody that I wanted to work with. It's like, as I said, this is only an interest. It's only a passion. It's not a business. So I don't need to coach people for Mr. Olympia.
Well, could you imagine Dorian taking someone to stage? Could you imagine what people would think?
Dorian, well, that is kind of happening now. I mean, it may happen because. So, you know, Sergio Oliveira Jr., yeah. He just moved to Marbella to come and train there and everything. And then I said, look, I'll help you out. So,
that's got
I mean, it's a guy with the potential there.
Yeah.
And I think I can help him. So,
what's he called?
Sergio Oliveira Jr. Well, his old man was 3 times Mr. Olympia. So, you know, he's very well genetically. But one reason or another is never really maximized his potential. So, yeah, I'm helping them out at the moment, so that could be interesting. We'll see what happens next year.
That would be part of the legacy, wouldn't it? Donating and took someone else.
That'd yeah, that would be great. That would be a great story, and he seems to be committed. And I'd like to see a Mr. Olympia that's like 6 foot tall,
yeah.
With wide shoulders and a small waist. You know, like this is the best male physique in the world. No disrespect to anybody, and everyone's working hard and everything like that, but if you took the guys that are Mr. Olympia now, in the last couple of years, and you show that to a member of the public and say, that is the ultimate male physique. Well, hold on, he's only like 5'4 or something, isn't he? And he's like a fridge. How is that possible? Yeah? It's not, you know, it's, you look at Arnold or Lee Haney, or like, wow, yeah, I get it. That's the ultimate male physique. But so I'd like to see a bit more. You know, Sergio is like the same height as me or something, touching on the 6 foot. He's got great shape. I think it would be great. It's a great story. It'd be great for the sport. So we will see. We'll see what happens.
What's your thoughts on Arnold Schwarzenegger? Sorry, mate.
Yeah.
Sorry, mate. Go on.
I'm just interested to know how you dealt with coming away from competition.
Wow.
Steve's just retired.
That's the whole.
Second in the universe.
Mate. Fucking nightmare, what can I tell you? I mean, really, I'm an extreme person. So I always said, like, this aspect of taking the steroids and everything, I'm doing that because I'm a professional and it's basically a requirement. Yeah, otherwise, forget it. Yeah? It's like being a model and not being able to wear makeup or something, it's like, it's part of the thing, yeah? So, when I finish competing, that's it, I'm gonna stop taking steroids, which is really not a wise way to do it. You need to come down, taper down, and you're probably gonna have to be on some replacement testosterone, which is what I eventually realized, but it was a personal battle. I didn't even want to do that. I was like, no, I told myself I'm going to stop, so I'm going to stop. And not only had I lost my total absolute focus and dedication goal that I had for the last 15 years or whatever it was, it's gone now. I mean, why are you getting up in the morning? What are you doing? I'm going to go to the gym. Yeah, but why are you going to the gym? Why are you going to the gym now? I'm going to the fucking gym because I feel like I'm going to hang myself. And if I go to the gym, I'll feel better afterwards. That's where I was at, you know? So I think the gym saved my life. I was that low. And so I've lost my direction or career or whatever. It's more than a fucking career. It's like, you know, it's absolute obsession that it's not there anymore. And it wasn't a controlled... I like to control everything. That's why I like control contests I went in and everything. But I couldn't control this. I got injured and it was the end of my career and that's that. And it's good night and it's over. And because of my extreme nature as well, I stopped taking steroids. I basically cut myself off from, you know, the international bodybuilding community, which not like now, it's the internet and everything. You got to call people up and talk. And I just didn't want to. So it's, and then I'm looking around me and saying, well, I've got to face up that I wasn't really happy in my marriage for the last couple of years. And now it's all coming into focus because I was like this for so long that whatever problems are here and here, like, ah, fuck that, I can't be distracted. Now it's like, you know, everything started falling apart. So it was a really tough time.
How do you feel the void then?
Because, you know, I was focusing on what I lost. Yeah, but what I learned to do is focus on like, well, mate, you're 35 years old, you're financially secure, you fucking can do anything now that you want. But it took me a time to figure out, well, what do I want to do, you know, because this is all I know. It's what I've been doing this since I'm 21. In all that time, I never socialized. I lost my fucking skill or understanding how to even socialize with people because I just cut myself off and I trained and I slept and I trained and I slept and I ate and for so long and now that's not necessary. And the world's your oyster, you know, like, what do you want to do? Eventually it turned around to that, but it took me many years to like, it took me until now to be like where I feel like I'm in a totally peaceful place now, and I'm much more happy and joyous than when I was bodybuilding. Like, look at my pictures when I was bodybuilding. It's very difficult to find a picture of me smiling because I just felt like I was in a war. I was like a guy in a war, and I was just like, all the time, all the time, all the time. I ain't got no time for smiling. Yeah, you just won the Mr. Olympia and 150 grand. Yeah, well, I got to start training for next year. Yeah? Mrs., take the check. Take the check, put it in the bank, pay the bills and go to the gym.
That's why I can't.
That's it, you know?
Mindset.
Very, very difficult, yeah. Very difficult. But I have that, you know, I have that ability to focus and push and get through anything if I need it. It's there, it's a skill set that I have. I don't need it all the time, but it's there if I need it. You know, that inner strength, that things come along in life and they're going to knock you over and you're going to get back up again. Just keep knocking me over, man. I'll keep getting back up. Like, that's what I learned. And I've always got that if I need it. I just don't need it all the time, you know? At the moment.
Thank you.
Anyone else?
What motivated you to go to the gym originally? You know, like they say, different athletes and different professions. They'll maybe say, like, you might get a kid that sees like a plane go by and they'll go, I'm going to be a pilot.
Yeah.
What was your moment that you went, that's the direction?
There were steps, you know. So when I was still at school, I was a big fan of Bruce Lee and I was always doing squats and push-ups and sit-ups in my room, like every day, like, you know, Bruce Lee poster on the wall. And then I saw bodybuilders and I started doing some weight training. But then at 16, I left school. My mum decided to leave Birmingham and go live somewhere else. And I'm like, screw that, I'm staying here. But, you know, then I was staying at my mate's place or staying here or like for years, it was like that. And then I got in some trouble. I got sent to the detention center for a few months. And in there, you do cross-country runs, you do circuit training, they had weights. There was a screw in there that was a power lifter. So we've got guys doing bench and squat and all that stuff. So I'm like, there's 300 guys in here. I'm stronger than all of them. I got a better physique. Everyone treats me with respect. Even the prison officers are like, yeah, you're different, you. You're not like one of these mugs that are coming in here. Oh, this is it then. I always felt my whole life that I was different. And I couldn't understand people's lives. Like, so you get a job, yeah? Get married or something, you have some kids, and you go to work, and you eat, and you shit, and you get up and do it again tomorrow. And that's people's lives, that's how they live. Fuck that, man, that ain't for me. I just always knew that, I always knew. And then when I picked up those weights, this is it. This is changing my life, yeah? And I don't have anything. I don't have parents around me. I don't have education. I don't have anything, yeah? I'm gonna fight, and this is my channel out. This is my route to a different life where I can travel the world. Like my horizons were just like this, where everyone around me was like that. I couldn't understand it. I was like, that's not life, something else. And when I got this, I was like, this is my vehicle out of all this into a different life. And it's not that I want to do this. I fucking got to do this. Like, do or die, I'm doing this. I'm putting everything into this. Mates have got cars. Mates are going out, getting girls, all this. I didn't give a shit. I didn't care. I didn't have a car till I was 26. Just catch the bus everywhere. I was British champion. British champion, thousands of people. British champion, you're in the magazines. I came back to a council estate with no bed. I had a mattress on the floor, no carpet, an old TV that barely worked. I'm British champion. I got my trophy, but I'm still living in a shithole. I mean, that's how it was until I opened my gym and started earning money. But that's it. As a kid, I was always like, I wanted to travel the world, and bodybuilding's allowed me to do that. I've been all around the world and met great people, friends, you know, come to a place like this. We're all kind of in the same game or the same ethos, and you make friends. I've got friends all around the world. If I want to go to Japan, Australia, Brazil, or anywhere, I can call them up. And I know people around the world. Like, even if I was a billionaire, I wouldn't have that experience. I could travel all around the world in my private jet, but I wouldn't have these relationships and people all around the world that I know that I met through bodybuilding. So, financially, bodybuilding, it's nowhere like most pro sports. You know, you could be a moderately shitty football player and make a good living, right? But in bodybuilding, you've got to be the best, you know, top six, top 10 in the world. That's making an okay living. Okay, yeah, not fucking football player wages. But there's other benefits, stuff like that. Travel all around the world and everything that I would never have been able to do.
And else? You said you were very OCD about everything. Did you ever feel that, I'm not sure that you had a coach, I mean, you had a training partner.
Coaches didn't exist. Like, what is a coach? I don't even know what's a coach. So I did everything myself, and for me that was kind of one of the beauties of bodybuilding that drew me to it. Like, shit, so I gotta like find out. I mean, no internet. I gotta go to the library, man, and borrow books or buy a book on nutrition. I had a book like this, Nutritional Almanac, with all the breakdowns of the macros and everything. I read that. I've got to work out my diet. I've got to work out my training plan. If I'm going to take steroids, I've got to work out how and what and to do and everything like that. So this is an individual pursuit. And when I go to a competition, if I win, I did that. If I lose, I did that. And now it's like, yeah, we're going to compete in... Who's fucking we? We are going to compete. No, you are going to compete. You might have a coach and a nutritionist, but they ain't on stage, mate, competing, yeah? You are going to compete. And I was always very individual, very comfortable to be on my own, like a lone wolf, basically. I mean, I could fit in with groups, but I'll bounce out and I'm good on my own. So the fact that it was an individual endeavor, where it was all down to me, that's what I loved about bodybuilding. Because up until that point, when I was young, my life was not in my control. And I thought, these fucking parents and this and that, they're idiots. Yeah? I can't wait to get my life in my hands. So it, psychologically, bodybuilding was, it's almost made for me, you know, because I'm that guy that can just wants to do everything himself. And there were really no coaches. The first guy that I spoke to that had a coach was Flex Wheeler. I was like, I don't get it. And he's like, yeah, but I'm American. And like at school, we have coaches for basketball. You have a coach for football. You have a coach. So that there, he was coming from that background where he was used to that. For me, I was totally foreign, the idea to have a coach. So it's different now. You know, people have got coaches, nutritionists. Not saying that's bad, but you got to also learn yourself, because you're in your body. You're living, you are in your body. So a coach can ask you how you're feeling, this and that, but you got to understand that, yeah? And don't rely too much on people. If you have a coach, have a nutritionist, learn from them. So in the future, you ain't going to rely on them. You know you're self-sufficient. You can do it yourself, you know? That's what I would advise.
What impact did meeting Mike Mensah have on your training? Did it change your training that much?
No, not really drastically, because I was already training, short, intense. I read all Mike's stuff when I was a kid and adapted it a bit and kept records and thought, this works, this doesn't work. So anyway, I was already training pretty much like that. And then I trained with Mike and he's like, what are you doing? I was like, you know, do whatever, warm up, couple of sets. Then I'll go to failure on a set. And then I might drop it down 10% and then do another set to failure just to make sure I've nailed it and then move on. It's like, well, how about trying cutting it back just to one set where you put everything in? So I did that and I got another little, you know, another little burst of growth. So it was 95% there, and Mike was, you know, he's like my hero, my idol when I started bodybuilding. I'd say he probably wasn't my favorite physique, but his intellect and the teaching and everything, that's the logical kind of thinking I related to that. So I met him, I think, 91, 92, and we did a few workouts together, and it massively boosted his personal training business. It's because people, he never went out and claimed that he coached me for Mr. Olympia or anything, but people kind of assumed that and thought that. And I was like, hey, great. I mean, you know, Mike helped me, inspired me a lot when I was a kid. If he's now getting, like, you know, his association with me now is financially benefiting him, good luck for him, man, because, you know, he inspired me. So that was the relationship, really, that we worked out a couple of times. But we never discussed nutrition, because I thought Mike's knowledge of nutrition was incorrect, yeah? And we never discussed steroids. We never discussed the aspects of contest prep or anything, because I didn't ask him, because I thought I already knew more than him on that aspect. So we're only discussing actually training that we're doing in the gym, which of course, getting ready for a contest, that's just one aspect. But that's the only aspect that we shared in. And yeah, I respected him. But he was a funny guy. He was very intelligent and everything, but he had substance abuse issues. So he could be a totally different person. And one day I spoke to that person and I didn't like it, and I didn't speak to him again. It's unfortunate, because I didn't speak to him before he passed away. I would like to, but yeah, it was like a split personality, like situation, I guess. And I didn't know, because I knew him like to be quite, well and intelligent and everything, but he had issues with amphetamines and alcohol and stuff. So yeah, it's a shame, but definitely a massive influence on myself.
Was there anyone that you trained with that was like maybe matched you as a bastard, or just blew you away, like was shocked by their intensity?
Nah, it was the other way around. Chris Cormier is a good friend of mine, became good friends. I mean, he'll say straight up, he said, listen, I trained with Charles Glass, Robbie Robinson, everybody in Gold's Gym, California, and I thought I trained hard and I thought I knew what I was doing until I trained with Dorian, and it's fucking like being reborn. It's a totally different experience. So those are his words, man, not mine. So no, I never trained with somebody. I trained with people that came and they brought it, and they, you know, there was a guy called Billy Payne. I don't know if, Billy Payne was like the British myth, like guy that, you know, I heard he was up there in Yorkshire bench pressing 600 pounds and squatting 700 pounds and is, you know, and he used to come down and train with me now and then. And yeah, he'd keep fairly close, but I've never trained with anybody that's made me feel like that. It's always the other way around, so.
Keep you motivated in the gym.
Being the best part
of it. I got no problem with motivation, man. Like, I is like saying, well, are you motivated to have sex? I fucking like it, so I'm going to do it. I don't need to be, you know, I don't need no motivation. It's the same thing going to the gym. I fucking love it, man. Nobody needs to motivate me or tell me or anything. I'm self-motivated.
Last night and
don't
like having sex.
I'm particular about which sex. I'm an old school, like women type of guy.
You mentioned about steroids before, actually, so now you could Google any steroid and there'd be loads of websites up there. Yeah. Back in the 80s, where did you find all your information?
There was one book, Underground Steroid Handbook. It was like photocopied, stapled together thing that a guy called Dan Duchesne wrote. So there was that. Or there was a book called Anabolic Steroids in Sports, James Wright. But that was a bit more intellectual and very conservative. And I met him and he said, like, I couldn't say too much in my book because I was working for the military at the time. So that was a bit conservative, where Dan Duchesne was a bit like crazy. So there was just those two books and whatever little bits of stuff you could pick up in the magazines. Apart from that, it's word of mouth, yeah? Like, what's this guy doing? What's that, you know? That's how we learned at the time. And I would say the dosages were lower because, you'd ask, what does this guy, and the accepted level of what were being used then was probably less. And I think we were more like, shit, you better not take so much Dynabol because it could damage your liver and all this stuff. And we were more cautious then. We thought steroids were potentially more dangerous than maybe they are. I mean, of course, if you abuse, anything is going to damage you. So that's how we got the information. And I didn't get back to the contest prep, yeah? So we talk about the diet and everything. So these are just the way that I did things, but there's no like, no studies in this, there's no accepted way, you know, it's more or less people that have been experimenting over the last, 60 years or so. I mean, the Mr. Olympia started in 1965, right? There is no Mr. Olympia winner that was not taking steroids. Even 1965, Larry Scott's on record, probably taking very little, 30 milligrams of D-bol a day, that's all they were using back then, but they were using, you know. So it's this people, you know, trying it and experimenting, and I was actually having a blood test with my doctor two or three times a year, which nobody else was doing. And I know why, because I first went to my doctor and I said, I'm taking steroids, I just want to be doing my blood test and everything to make sure I'm all right. And it's like very negative and really didn't want to do it till he saw me on TV at the World Games. And he's like, you're doing this for a serious thing. I said, yeah, man, that's what I was trying to tell you. And he's like, okay, come and see me. But it's very, very basic. All right, so off season, I just use probably like everyone who use testosterone, Deca or Equipoise, Boldenone it was called. It's a bit like Deca, mid-range anabolic. And D-Bol or Androl. Whereas for contest, I try to stick to non-aromatizing, So like testosterone and some D-ball, stuff like that. Aromatization is like you're putting this male hormone in your body, so it's going up here, where female hormone, estrogen, is quite similar. So the body just converts that excess testosterone into estrogen, which can cause you to hold water and you'll be a bit puffy and all that stuff, but didn't really matter in the off season because you're there to lift heavy weights. Pre-contest, I would go to compounds that don't aromatize, i.e. they don't convert to estrogen, which can then retain water and maybe blur your conditioning. For contests, I would use Parabolone, which is Trenbolone. And I'm shocked now with like how much Trenbolone people use. Because we were told back then, just by, you know, the guys that used to distribute it, Parabolone, 76 milligrams, there's a reason it's 76 milligrams and not 200 or three, like other compounds, because it's very powerful, yeah? And don't use too much of this because it's harsh on your system. It could be harsh on your kidneys. I don't know where that information came from, but that was just what we heard, yeah? So on average, I take two of those a week. So 76, it's 152 milligrams, Trenbolone. That's it, you don't need more than that, yeah? I hear people use 600-800 milligrams of Trenbolone. First of all, is it real? If it is, you're gonna have trouble. That's too much, yeah? So Trenbolone, Primobolan, which is also hard to get. Don't forget, in the 80s and 90s, there's no underground steroids. There is none, it's all pharmaceutical and you can get it and it's, you know, so if you got 76 milligram, you know it's 76 milligram. If it's 250 milligrams sustenon, you know it's 250 milligrams. Now, it could be good, it could be not, who knows. So Primobolan, Parabolone, Anavar, and when I was a pro, got to that level, growth hormone as well. As an amateur, I didn't use that, wasn't even available. So there, that's it, dosages. Off season, I'd probably use more, so maybe like up to 1,000 milligrams of testosterone, 500 milligrams boldenone or deca or something like that, and maybe 50 milligrams of dynabol a day. But that'd be a maximum like 5 weeks, and then taper down for a few weeks, and then a few weeks off. So that wasn't something taken consistently. That's like the peak that I'm telling you. Pre-contest, 150 milligrams Trenbolone, maybe 500 milligrams of Primobolan Depot, a little bit of test propionate, maybe 300 milligrams. Anavar is doing like 50 milligrams a day. You know, that's it. Probably not massive to what people use these days, but that was, I would say, just average of what a pro would be using, pretty much talking to other guys and, you know, stuff like that.
Anyone else?
What advice would you give someone of my age on TRT? And how much would you...
Check your testosterone level, your free testosterone level. If it's not in the top half, or preferably the top third of the range, then take some testosterone and put it there. It varies from one person to another, you know, you have to monitor your levels to get it right, but on average, about 150 milligrams a week it would be a good, you know, more or less. Some people might have a bit more, a bit less to get in that range that you want to be in. And microdosing seems to be the best way to do now. I talked to the top guys in the States that are anti-aging and hormone replacement, and it's less disruptive to take, let's say, 250 milligram of testosterone. Instead of whacking that in once every 10, 12 days, you take a little bit like every other day or something like that. That way it's like that rather than, because it's this disruption that causes the negative effects. Like sometimes your hemoglobin, your red blood cells can go a bit too high and you don't want that because then your blood gets a bit sticky and, you know, your risk of heart attack and everything is going to go up. So you keep an eye on that. Sorry? If it's a replacement, it's a replacement. Yeah, that means if you take it away, you haven't got enough. So TRT is lifelong. You know, taking steroids on and off when you're younger, maybe that's not permanent, but if you get to a certain age, and now it's like an epidemic. of low testosterone in males. Now an 18-year-old male has 50% of the testosterone that I had when I was 18 in 1980. That's how much testosterone levels have dropped. So it used to be like, well, you know, if you're over 50, you might want to check your test levels. Now it's like, if you're over 35, you might want to check your test levels, yeah? And keeping your testosterone in a good place, not excessive, a good place, is very good for your health. Low testosterone is very bad for your health, yeah? So, but there's still some stigma about this because it's testosterone and it's male and male aggression and this and that. I mean, females have been having hormone replacement for fucking, since I was a kid, but men somehow, now it's getting more acceptable, but somehow there's still like this thing where you shouldn't do that because you become too masculine and too powerful. We want you to be weak and, you know, submissive. Fuck that, man. Let's be barbarians, you know?
So we have got one female, Ash, who competes, she's a bikini girl. Advice for her, her dream is always to step on the Olympia stage. When she goes up on stage, she's up against some amazing girls and there's always a massive lineup of bikini girls. This Ash lives and breathes this sport, it's her life.
You know what, mate, it's like, what I know about.
Yeah.
And I couldn't give advice to a bikini competitor because I know anything about it, mate. Like, I could help you to get lean maybe and stuff like that, but I don't even know what the judges are looking for. I'm not sure that they know. Yeah. They're looking for that, that's what they're looking for. Yeah, so you get 20, 30 girls on stage, there's more money, right? But how do you judge them and separate them? I ain't got a clue because, you know, there's supposedly bikini was created to make, it's basically like an easy category. Where a young girl, if she's a young girl in your early 20s and you do a 6 months, 12 months of training in the gym, you can step up on stage and you can do a competition and you bring money into the sport and you bring your mates, yeah, and you bring your friends, well, expanding the potential revenue that's coming into the contest. And then they'll have guidelines which says this and that. Oh, okay, the bikini category is created basically to get more people in. And really, the intention was to be a natural category.
Yeah.
But human nature being what it is, a couple of girls from the bikini thing will think, you know, what if I take a little bit of Anavar and Clenbuterol? Ooh, look at this, wow. And the judge rewards it.
Yeah.
Then all the girls got to go down that road, yeah, if you want to compete. And I'm not a big fan of women competing and using steroids. My ex-wife, my wife, Gal, was a South American champion. World champion, pro winner, all that stuff. Using a little bit of stuff, but I was like, I don't want you to do this. I don't want you to do this anymore. So I don't like the idea of women taking steroids because it's a male hormone and I think it's quite damaging. And I think we're gonna see an epidemic of mental health problems with girls that are going into this. Because once you take hormones as a woman, and as a man, it's a big effect, but as a woman, it's a massive effect, yeah? And for you to stop doing that, trust me, when you stop doing that, you will be depressed. You will be turning into a Pillsbury Dough girl, and you'll look in the mirror and you'll be like, fuck, I'm gonna have to go back on. And that's that. That's so, not a big fan of it, but it's just a personal opinion, and I couldn't advise a woman on competing because I don't know enough about it. I'm not interested enough, and there's like issues that I have no idea about, like what happens if you have your period before a contest, and I have no idea, like, you know what I mean? So I'd rather not give advice on something I don't feel I'm qualified.
She stepped on stage at the Universe, now the Universe, then the girls were diced, who she was up against. Ash has a perfect natural look.
Yeah.
She grafts, she does a cardio, she eats, everything is 100%. Some of these girls are foreign. One of them had visible marks in the right and left side of the glute where you can see what's been happening. And that girl was rewarded, and she come third, and the girls were really tight and hard, and it just seemed like the industry was going away from bikini and almost to a train category. So I just wanted Ash to know that, where does she go? For me, I'm in the same mindset.
Yeah.
I think taking steroids for a female is going to be massively damaging, not something I would want to.
Yeah.
I wouldn't want to give her back to her dad and say, there's your son. Do you know what I mean? I would like to do that to my daughter.
It's tough, and it's like, you know, as I say, they created the bikini category for like a fit young girl that goes to the gym. Don't need to have abs and all that, just a nice shape. And they created the men's physique with the shorts on. The idea is a beach body, shape, but abs, don't need to train your legs, you've got shorts on. That means more people can do that. So we get more people, where a bodybuilding, you've got to train for 5, 6 years, 10 years to, you know, to be able to compete. So the idea is an easy category, get more people in, I get it. But then all the people start using steroids. So now the bikini girls are as muscular as the other, you know, the bodybuilders used to be back in the 80s. And what do you do? Create another category, like bikini minus or something? It's just going to keep happening, you know, it's human nature.
How
so. Do
you compare bikini athletes when it first came out to it? It's completely different. Yeah. And anybody who competes as an amateur cannot step up.
Yeah.
Into the pro
and
do anything because
it's
just so
hard.
Steve's
a judge, he's an
average
judge,
yeah.
So
he gets it. Yeah.
Very hard to judge these, you know, got 20 women on stage, like, it's really hard to separate them. So maybe if the girl that's a little bit more muscular, she's got, you know, she's got a little bit of juice, she stands out, so she becomes the winner, and then, like, everyone's chasing that. If that's what they want, I need to be like that. And that happens. Like, Gal used to do figure, and figure is like how the bikini girls look now, you know? So each category just keeps getting more and more muscular. But as I said, that's human nature, isn't it? It's competitive, people competitive do what they gotta do. If the judges were to go to the bikini girls and say, listen, you, now you're too muscular, so that's why you've been placed low, then it would change. But if you reward the girls for being muscular, then everyone's going to chase that as the ideal. Yeah, that's inevitable, really.
We're at fault, because you were saying about an epidemic going for mental health for women, and we've got to look at the federations who are awarding that, maybe think that they're actually part of the problem.
Well, it's a business, you know. They're just interested in making money, like any business. They're not particularly concerned about the wellness of the people doing it. That's their choice if they want to compete. We're just here to put it on, and we're a business, we want to make money, so we need more people to compete. I don't think anyone's seriously sitting there, as they were not with the men back in the 80s and 90s, like, until we had some deaths from diuretics. Then Mohammed Benaziza died from diuretics. Andreas Monser died after the competition. Diuretics and, so, and whatever else. So there were deaths in the sport. So then people did sit up and say, hey, and they were, they had drug testing for diuretics at 96 Mr. Olympia. I don't know why. Oh, I do know why. Because later on they did it and Jay Cutler got caught and he challenged the testing and it didn't stand up to the challenge. So, like, forget it now, you know? Yeah, I believe so. I may be wrong, but I believe that he challenged it legally and the testing was not standing up. So, I mean, once it's been challenged once, like, it's useless. So, but there was some concern because it's not good for the sport if people are dying. Yeah. It's bad publicity. That's bad for business. Whether it's, you know, people are really having a human concern or it's just bad business, I don't know. But there were some concern about that. Because it's instant. Somebody's died after a competition. Yeah. Not like somebody's died 15, 20 years later and you don't connect it with that, with the competition.
Because this is the health and fitness industry. But really, are we on the fitness or on the fitness? Because the health doesn't ever really come in, does it? Is it healthy? Is it?
It's what you want to make it, you know? But a competitive sport has nothing to do with health. Yeah. Like, I mean, if you're in it, you know that, yeah? You're just in it to win. That's, you know, and the people that have that kind of a mindset, have that tunnel vision, have that determination to do that. That's the nature of the beast, man. You know, like they did a survey. I think it was Dr. Goldman, he works for the International Olympic Committee. So he asked professional athletes, including bodybuilders, but also other sports like track and field, stuff like that. So a theoretical question. If I could give you a pill, which would guarantee the Mr. Olympia, the gold medal, or whatever it is in your chosen profession, If I could give you a pill and you're guaranteed to win, but you're going to die in 15 years' time, would you take it? Majority of people said, yes, I would. Yeah. That's the nature of the people. That's the, you know, that's the nature. That's the fucking mindset you have to have. Yeah, you know, the people you're competing against are that driven, that it's so important to them that, yeah, I could live to be 100 years old, or I could live to be 50, but I've fucking got a gold medal. I'm going for the 50. Yeah, that's, you know, I would have said yes myself. Fuck it, man. You know? I changed my mind, like, no. I didn't mean it.
From when you've worked out your kind of training regime, the way of training that suited you best, did you still then need to adapt the actual exercises? Or
no. Huge mistake. Oh, I'm going to change my routine every 4 or 6 weeks. Bullshit, huh? If your squats work for you, it's a good exercise for your legs, you need to be doing squats. Well, you're gonna change it to one-legged cable bullshit that don't do anything, just because I've gonna change. Like, your body doesn't know which exercise it's doing, it just knows how hard it's working, and if it's working beyond its normal capacity, then it has to adapt to that. That's it, you know? I've done a couple of videos about it because it's like pisses me off. I'm like, myself, Arnold Schwarzenegger, Lee Haney, Ronnie Coleman, name them, do the same exercises day in and day out, you know, because they're the exercises that work. You want big legs, you've got to do leg press or squats. You want a big back, you've got to do bent over rows. Like, that's it. There's no reason to change your exercises unless it's a psychological reason that somehow you just get bored with this exercise or stale or whatever, and I change that exercise. All right, you're stuck in that barbell row. Let's do dumbbell row, one side at a time. It's pretty similar, but maybe your brain now gets excited because, ooh, I'm doing something different. So then your physical output is more because you only output what the brain tells you to output, yeah? So if you're stagnant and bored and not looking forward to it, maybe there's a reason to change it. But that's really the only reason. And the other thing that is important to say is in this heavy, high-intensity training, you cannot do it all the time, continually, yeah? Because you'll burn out. Yeah. So in my experience, 5 or 6 weeks of pushing, 4 reps, more weight, more, you start to get to a plateau. So then I would advise people to drop down. Now you're going to use lighter weights, pump, maintain. So it's like an active rest instead of not going to the gym at all. We're still going, we're still putting some resistance through, still pumping some blood, but it's way below capacity. We're chilling, let the nervous system recover, and then go again. So probably 6 weeks, 2 weeks. But everybody's a little bit different as far as their metabolism, how well they can recover. And this is also going to be a big difference. If you're using hormones, you're going to recover more quickly. Hence why pro bodybuilders can train 6 days a week. And if you try it and you're not on stuff, good luck with that. You're going to get smaller because you're not going to be able to recover. Yeah, they don't tell you that. The guys, oh, 6 days a week or twice a day. Impossible unless you're enhanced.
The question is because I saw a little clip of that video with you talking about that, but obviously yeah, not getting the full picture. And I trained with my PT a week ago, and after the session, well, partway through the session, we were doing very similar exercises, just in a slightly different way to get to failure. And partway through the session, he looked at me and was like, I'm getting you, aren't I? And the only way I could describe it was I'd got to the phase of when Terminator, and then you see the light go out of his eye.
Yeah.
That's how it made me feel. I felt like the light was going out part way through the session.
You got to die a little bit to be reborn, yeah, you know?
Afterwards, he said, so I've trained your Dorian Yates style today.
Ah.
And I was sore for days.
Well, maybe you train with me later on and see if it really was Dorian Yates style, yeah?
Then go back and tell the PT, you are full of shit. This is Dorian Yates.
I was going to ask, you know, obviously in the physiques, especially in the pros and stuff, the physiques are quite there, especially in the legs and stuff. What's your opinion on that? What do you think it's down to compared to obviously your time?
Possibly insulin use, where just retaining water and the little separation, the details are not there. and simply being scared to just come down a little bit in weight. You know, oh no, I've got to be this weight. No, it's a visual sport. Yeah, I didn't know scales on stage. Nobody cares. It's what you look like. Yeah. So I look at the guys often and I'm thinking, just another 4 weeks, another 10 pounds, it would look much better. But the standard is the standard, and the standard for the open class is not seem to be as concerned with conditioning as they used to be. So, you know, if the judges reward this, this is what you're going to aspire to look like. And why would you kill yourself, lose another 10 pounds, if that's the look that seems to be in vogue?
Just ask them, in terms of your, obviously you're the shadow and you're still the shadow, and you can tell that after your Olympias and stuff, a lot of them are still like related and stuff, and you still do your own thing. What's your relationship with, like, the previous Mr. Olympia's currents, and do you have any favourites?
have some water. Mr. Olympia's, I don't really have a relationship with any of them. I mean, yeah, I mean, we're professionals, we respect each other. The fact that people get the wrong idea in that he was my coach or somehow had some influence on my career, not really, because I was three times Mr. Olympia before I ever trained with him. And anyone that trains with me, Dean's at the back there training with me, a few good lads train with me, they come to train with me. I decide everything. I'm the one that's putting everything together. They're following because they're coming to learn from me. So with the current, the way things are now, a lot of people get the wrong impression, like he was my coach or something like that. No, I was his coach. He was just following me. And yeah, I get it. People like it, that he makes his shouts and all that stuff. But everyone's got their style. And that was one day in the gym that we filmed over all the many years that I trained, and that was a snapshot. So if you'd come and film me 3 years earlier, I would be training with somebody else, and it would have been a lot quieter, you know? So it's all entertaining and all that stuff, but what I'm trying to say is all that, it's not necessary. It was entertaining, and the kids love it, I get it, but it wasn't. It was a training partner. In those days, we had training partners, just training buddies, like me and you were trained together. And if I'm bigger and more experienced than you, you're just going to do what I do because you want to learn, you know? So that was the situation.